Today on the Authors Exchange, we sit down with JD Schaefer, author of Wine of Your Life.
Demonic virus is unleashed during a weekend getaway, which uncorks death and mayhem, turning the unsuspecting weekenders into crazed maniacs set on devouring anyone in their path. Now, without further ado, Mr. J.D. Schaefer, tell us about your book.
It doesn't take itself too seriously. It's a fun read. I have the attention span of about 2 or 3 hours. That's what I wrote it for, was sit on the beach and get some excitement, maybe have a glass of wine on a Saturday night. Chicago.
The Authors Exchange. Your host, Captain Christopher Jerk. Brought to you by The Charted Life. And sponsored by Whither We Tend, a novel by Captain Christopher Jerk. Welcome to The Authors Exchange.
Hey there, folks. This is Captain Christopher German, and we have done it. The first season is officially finishing up with this episode. This is the season finale, and we got a real great guy who's got a really funny, well, that's not a funny book. It's kind of a scary horror funny. It's a great little read, especially as we come into beach season now, and you're looking for something you can finish in a couple of hours on the beach and still work on your tan and never be able to get to sleep again in your life or drink a bottle of wine. This is the book for you. But we'll talk to you about that in a second. But first, let me talk to you a little about what we did this season, because we had a huge, huge season. We started out in New York City, or New Jersey, New York, that area down there. We had Chris Pascarell and Dan Chavillo, and then we jumped up to Northern New York with Dan Doherty. Then there was out to Cali, where we left talked with Tanya Ross, and then we popped over across the pond to Brian Wagstaff. After that, we stopped in, I believe she was in Germany at the time, Grace Grossman. And then after that, we went down to Nigeria, and we talked to Odin Achukis. After that, up to Ontario, where we ran into Ian Richard Gill, who's author of Distant Kingdoms. And beyond that, then we went down to the Caribbean with Cynthia Zabnett Hovey, and then back to the Middle America with Arlene Marone, Lomazoff Marone. After that, we went down to Arizona, where Diane Ebert Beef was hanging out, and she told us just about on Treglada Beach. We had Alicia Adrega, which I believe she was in the Czech Republic, as well was Nick Gerard was in the Czech Republic as well. Back over to Doug Rappaport. Where the hell was he? I think he was in Czechoslovakia. I don't know where he was. He was someplace. Now he's in America. Yeah, he's in America. All right. So I'm trying to put this whole season back together just get it out there. And we've been all over the place. And if you've enjoyed these episodes, we really would love your support on Patreon. That's what really has been keeping this going is the fine people that have helped us keep this up and going with about $1.50 is all you got to contribute. And it helps keep this on the air. So thank you so much for everybody that has supported us this season through Patreon. Okay, that's my seasonal wrap up. We're going to do a little bit of a review at the end of this episode, but let's get to the meat of this episode right now. The really important man of the hour, this guy, JD Schaefer. If you've seen any of his books online, he's got some fun stuff to read, not least of which is the one that I got to take a look at it. But before we talk any more about the book, about him or the book or him or anything like that, let me get to the little description that I do at every episode, and I'll tell you about the guy. His name, J.D. Schaefer. He was born and educated in Texas, and he is a devoted husband and father of two rambunctious, adorable boys. An avid writer, he has written 3 books, all of which are available on Amazon, the most recent of which we will discuss today, Wine of Your Life. It's a horror novel set in a posh heritage vineyard where a demonic virus is unleashed during a weekend getaway. The host who travels the world to source this rare vintage uncorks death and mayhem for whoever drinks it by turning the unsuspecting weekenders into crazed maniacs set on devouring anyone in their path. Who will survive? Does the dog get killed off? You will not drink wine or sleep the same ever again after reading this fun and exciting tale of bacchanalian propensities gone awry. Now, without further ado, Mr. J.D. Schaefer, tell us about your book.
Hey, how you doing? Thanks for having me on. You described it perfectly. It's doesn't take itself too seriously. It's a fun read. It's not too rated R. There's no like uncomfortable situations or too much of this or that. I think there's maybe two cuss words in the whole thing. But it's just fun and a little bit gory and a little suspenseful. And I had a great time writing it. I like to write books that I would read myself. I have the attention span of about 2 or 3 hours. And so that's what I wrote it for, was to sit on the beach and get some excitement and maybe have a glass of wine on a stormy night and give it a nice read. And, you know, it's just been a fun experience.
Well, you're an Amazon writer and you're self-published, and we love self-published authors with this podcast that we're doing here. But this particular book, and one of the reasons I was really glad that this was our season end, is because it is so much fun. It is. I mean, it's scary, but it's kind of like, you know, like Freddy Krueger meets Jason meets that movie about there where they don't drink the Molo or is going to leave. it's a lot of fun. What inspired you to think about, you know, killing everybody off in a vineyard?
Well, number one, I do like wine. It's not really much of a horror situation in vineyards has been used much. I kind of got the idea, and it's not really an Easter egg, but this story actually exists in a universe of another creation of a Spanish horror movie series, and the virus kind of molds from their universe into this universe unofficially. But it's just kind of neat about that. And I just really enjoy these kinds of movies and these kinds of books. And I wrote a short story, kind of a horror one, where kind of everyone is happy and it's a happy ending. And my friends were like, no, that's a terrible ending. You can't do that. You have to have some kind of teeth at the end of it. So I hope the little twist at the end of this book and just the way it progresses, where it's not static. There isn't one thing that I try not to do is put too much detail into things. I know a lot of novelists, a lot of writers love to throw details, tell you every little thing. I like to let the imagination of the reader take hold and kind of give you those fine little details. So it's just... It's good for your imagination to read this book, I guess I should say.
Well, and I think it's perfectly timed because you are the father of two rambunctious kids and you hear them in the background back there. Oh, and you're not killing anybody in the house. That is a perfectly natural sound for a father of two kids to be screaming in the background.
Sorry about that. I tune them out sometimes.
How do I say this without sounding macabre? But how's a father of two come up with the idea of creating a bunch of zombies that rip each other's, you know, throats out in a vineyard with that sound behind you?
Well, I don't get like a lot of my stress out in of everyday life. I'm not an avid, you know, I don't go to the gym a whole lot. I don't run. I don't kickbox. So a lot of my, I guess, subconscious aggression has to take place in a creative environment, and I put that into a lot of my writing. One of my other books is about a hit woman, so it's a little bit violent too, and I don't know, it's just kind of easy to write.
Well, they're easy to read too, and I think that's one of the fun parts about these books is you know, they're a lot of times authors take themselves very, very seriously and they say, you know, I gotta build this giant and universe and put all these details in there. And as you said, you're not a big detail fan. I kind of appreciate that. But you know, the idea I think of trying to create the perfect beach read, I think that was inspiring because, you know, hey, it's July now and we're ready to go to the beach. And I want to introduce this book to some readers that are going to the beach.
Yeah. Great. Yeah. I mean, it's perfect for that, you know. When you get halfway through, turn over and tan the other side of yourself, you know. it'll be a good timer for that perfect tan.
Well, but avoid the wine because there's a deep seated demonic virus that is stuck inside the vines that she gets over from Spain, and she brings them back and she grows this demonic virus and quite unhappily or unknowingly passes this out to the world.
Right.
Well, tell me, riddle me this, you you twisted man who's trying to kill people with wine. Is there going to be a follow-up of this? Does this virus make it out of the vineyard, or does it get quelched right there? That was the big question I had at the end of the thing.
It makes it out of the vineyard. The crash at the end where the police officer finds the second bus, and that's kind of the cliffhanger of what happened to these people that had drank the wine, and where are they, and what's going to happen. I could see myself making a sequel to it. Kind of an end of the world thing. That's what the virus really wants. It just really likes living cells. That's where it can get its energy from anything. That's why it was able to rest in the roots and in the stems of those strong grape plants, because grapes are really strong. Their root systems, they grow in such difficult soil. And that's one of the ways that you can gauge your wine. I worked in a wine bar for a while. I was a bartender there. So that subconsciously, I might have seen people turn into zombies and crazy people after drinking too much wine.
That's exactly it. I mean, in my family, it's gin. If you put a glass of gin into grandmother or into my father, they turned into Jekyll and Hyde, and they would rip your face off. And the next morning, they wouldn't remember a thing about it. But in your world, it's wine. And as a wine sommelier, I'm sure you've seen that happen more than once. Huh?
Oh, yeah. Sometimes I wish that the virus was real to take care of a few of the unruly ones.
Yeah. So the only big question is, are zombies good tippers? I think is the only question after that.
Right.
Tell you what, let me take a quick little break here. We're going to come back and we're going to talk about your experience with the publishing. You've got three books out on Amazon, last of which is A Wine of Your Life. And I want to talk to you a little bit about how you became the author and how you got into the publishing thing and how you decided to independently publish. And we'll talk a little bit about that. And then at the end of this episode, we're going to do a quick wrap-up of the season and show everybody what we did. So come right back after this break. We will see you very, very shortly. Don't go very far, because we're going to come back with JD Schaefer, author of Wine of Your Life, and we're going to talk to him about being an independent.
When the world seems to shine like you've had too much wine, that's amore.
That's amore.
In the first season of The Authors Exchange, we spoke with 18 authors from around the world. We spoke with best-selling authors like Christopher Barry Dee, author of Talking with Serial Killers, and Diane Ebert Beef, author of A Grand Madness, 10 Years on the Road with U2. We also spoke with more than a dozen other new and indie authors who you may never have heard of if not for the Authors Exchange. In season two, we're going even bigger. We'll be pairing a book club with an author each week to discuss an aspiring author's novel and film that conversation on location in bookstores around the U.S. and Canada. This will give the readers who watch a chance to hear from the authors and learn about their books through the eyes of fellow readers. It will also showcase the places where people who like good books can find the books we feature. If you would like us to visit your bookstore for an episode of this season, please let us know. If you have a local book club that you think we should include in your episode, share their info as well, and we'll get back to you to schedule your episode. The Authors Exchange is all about connecting authors with readers. Help us out, won't you? Support us on Patreon at The Authors Exchange.
Haven't got the time. Yes, you can drink the water.
Welcome back. You are in the season finale of The Authors Exchange. I'm Captain Christopher German. We're going to come back again for season two, where we're going to do big, incredible things that are going to be coming down the pipe. So stay tuned. We're going to be getting a van. We're going to go to the bookstores. We're going to be talking with book clubs. We're going to be talking with 18 different authors about their books. And it's going to be huge. And we're hoping that people will support us on Patreon. And we got a crowdfunding campaign we're going to start. And it's all going to happen in the off season, because we got to get ready to start taping come the end of summer. And we're going to start taping again. But right now, today, we have JD Schaefer with us, who is the author of Wine of Your Life. It is a great tale to take with you on vacation. If you're still just thinking about heading out on vacation right now, stop into your good Kindle store, download it onto your iPad or onto your smartphone. If you want to get it, you can get a printed copy from Amazon. Show us that book again, sir, would you please? Speak up so the camera will come to
you. Oh, I'm sorry. Yeah, here it is. I was just listening to you, actually. This is a Wine of Your Life. It has a sub title of Drinking the Wine Before You Choke on Your Blood.
Yeah, you know,
which kind of gives people a preview of what it is, and you know, not to be taken too seriously, and you know, just a nice read.
Well, tell me a little bit about this. How did you get into the idea of self-publishing? And tell me a little bit about your experience with your previous two books and how you got to this book and all the other stuff.
Well, a long time ago, I always wanted to be a published author, a writer. And then, you know, life just happens. You have kids, you get married, things get put on the back burner. And then actually my dad was going around Texas taking pictures of old churches and self-published a book himself. And I was like, wow, that's something that I've always wanted to do. So I kind of took his lead, and I went back and looked at some books, some stories that I'd written, and just kind of copped them up today. I mean, not today, but you know, for today's times, things like that. And I Googled and I looked to see what I could do with publishing, and you know, traditional publishing takes a long, long time. That's what I keep hearing, and that's what I've seen when I've looked it up. And it's just the Amazon was so easy. The Kindle, you just upload it, you pick your cover, everything like that, and there's just some easy steps. And I found it really enjoyable. One of the things is marketing is very important, because like I haven't sold that many books doesn't mean that I'm not a good writer. It just means that no one knows about me, or no one knows about it, you know, any of these independent authors till they get their name out there. And that's a little bit of the trouble that I'm going through right now while I'm doing these podcasts and you know, just to get my name out there. But it's been a good experience. What I have advertised in on Facebook and Google, I did the Fiverr, I believe it's called. I paid a guy to do some social media things for me. They did a little bit of bumps here and there in the sales, but they've been pretty flat lately. But I kind of stopped advertising because it just got expensive. Google got really expensive for me.
Yeah. Well, and that's one of the reasons why I started this podcast, actually, is because I have a book. I'm a self-published author as well. And I wanted to figure out some way to get my podcast out there. And it was a relatively affordable way to do it. But it's actually, it's so much more fun talking about other people's books than talking about my book. So thank you so much for getting out there on the podcast. And, you know, thank you for sharing your book with us. I wonder if, you know, could you maybe read a little bit of a chapter for us? Just as a little taste of your writing?
Sure. Let's see. I'll just pick right here.
There you go.
Mary says goodbye to the wine tour guests and thanks them again for being part of tonight. Wine of Your Life has given all the guests leaving a branded umbrella from the gift store to keep them dry as they get on the bus, the wine queen number two. Mary sips of her wine as the bus drives out of sight down the road, back to civilization. Mary suddenly gets a sharp pain in her side and loses her balance. She recovers without falling over. She walks back inside slowly and heads to her office to sit down. She loses her balance again as she falls into her desk, spilling her wine on the floor. Duke starts to bark. She lands in her chair, causing it to roll against a bookshelf. She takes a few deep breaths, being suddenly exhausted. She becomes weak. She feels nauseous. Her eyes roll back into her head as she projectile vomits on her computer. She slips out of her chair onto the vomit on the floor and passes out.
Oh, and Mary is the host who finds this demonic wine and shares it with everybody else, and she goes down with it too, doesn't she?
Yeah, it was her idea, and she's the first to get the effects of it.
Well, JD, thank you so much for sharing your book with us, and thank you so much for supporting us this season on the Authors Exchange. This has been such a blast talking to you, and such a blast talking about this book. And I fully intend to, we'll hopefully get you a bump in sales out of your books on this. We'll put an Amazon link onto the YouTube page, and we'll try to get you some book sales out of this, because this is a fun little book to read, especially if you're a wine fan and you know, you have a good imagination like this guy does.
And It's actually still in under review, but I have an audio version of this coming out.
Oh, you do?
That I. Mm-hmm.
Who did you do the narration, or who did the narration?
A guy named Tom Chandler did it off of Fiverr.
Oh, that's cool.
He does a pretty good job. He does a good job. I enjoy it. And he put a few special effects in there, like rumbles of thunder and rain and things like that, to give it a little atmosphere. But nice. I was listening to it while I was making dinner the other night during a rainstorm, and it was cool. It was fun.
Nice. So that's going to be on Audible?
Yes.
Okay. Well, so for the viewers out there, if you don't know about Audible, it's a great little platform. What you do, it's for a monthly fee, but you can download all the books free of charge and listen to them in the car, or take them to the beach like this one, or anything like that. So check out Audible. You'll find Wine of Your Life on Audible. You'll also find Wither We Tend on Audible, narrated by yours truly. So just a little self-plug there for a sec. But
yeah, for sure.
Hey, JD, thank you so much for joining us today.
Thank you so much for having me. I really, really appreciate it.
Well, it is my pleasure, and it is absolutely my great pleasure to introduce all of the viewers to these wonderful books. We've had 18 of them this season. It has been a tremendous ride all the way along. We've been around the world. We've talked all kinds of subjects, from poetry to zombie drinking, wine drinking fools out in the middle of a vineyard someplace, and we've gotten everything in between. And it's been a hell of a run. So thank you so much for watching. I'm Captain Christopher German. This is the Authors Exchange. Today's author, JD Schaefer, Wine of Your Life. Go find it on Audible, go find it on Amazon, and make sure you tune in for season 2, when we're going to do some even bigger things and going around this country and talking to independent bookstores, independent authors, and people that like good books. Thank you.
I know watching. I'll be watching.
Good. Hey, but stay tuned right now, because we're going to do a little bit of a break, and we're going to come back. We're going to do a whole little wrap up of the season and show you some of the best moments that we have this season in the show. So stay tuned. Thank you for watching, and we'll be right back. Have you heard about Wither We Tend? Wither We Tend is a novel for Americans about Americans. It takes recent political events and fictionalizes them and imagines what the world will look like in a couple of years and how things could turn out. It is my hope that they don't turn out this way. And that's why I wrote the book. And that's why I'm hoping you will read the book. Because I don't want these events to take place in our country. And this book is my aim at trying to do that. I know not everybody likes to read. So I made it an audiobook. And with the code that you get in this video, you can download the Wither We Tend for absolutely free. And listen to it, all 7 hours of it, and enjoy it, I hope. I'm told it's pretty good. I've gotten lots of 5-star reviews, and I'm hoping you'll give it a 5-star review as well. Take a look at Wither We Tend, a novel about Americans for Americans.
But when she left me, I went to hell. Heaven was a drink of wine.
Well, you know, and I think I speak for men everywhere. If you're looking for something that you need to entertain your wife with, and you want to find something that is going to touch her heart, this, I think, is a great opportunity as such. Get the book, give it to her, write your name in it, and say, you know what? I Daniel gave these poems to me, and I'm going to give them to you. And it'll get you out of Dutch if you're in Dutch with your wife.
I tell every guy I know, use this book.
Use the book. Chris Pascarella, author of Destiny Revealed. And it's a 3-book trilogy. And we're talking to him today about all all the different aspects of the characters in this book. But this little segment, I want to talk about, Chris. I want to talk about, he was a cop for a bunch of years, and he transitioned into writing. And I want to talk about the process of how he decided to publish. But I also want to hear about his daughters, because they were a big part of this book. So let's start off with Chris.
But as the Harry Potter series ended, and there seemed to be a move towards vampire books, my daughters didn't really like that. And I started thinking about this story, just another wizard story kind of popped in my head. And I thought, okay, well, what if there's a whole family? What if there's twins? And I bounced it off my older daughter. And she's like, Dad, just write it down. and it grew from there.
When I was 20 years old, I was out and of the Army, and you know how things were in the 60s and 70s, and you know, you just, they were more interested in boozing and gambling and fighting and doing Irish stuff than you really weren't paying attention to what was going on around you as far as love and relationships went. And then you come to realize, and it's way too late. Fortunately, I have a lovely wife and I love her very much. We've been together over 40 years, so.
Well, that worked out, didn't it?
I had some explaining to do with the book.
I keep having that problem with my wife. I write female characters and she's like, that's something I said. Why are you writing that in the book? And she yells at me all the time.
That's one of those sophisticated things that I was really excited to see in this book, is that in a lot of ways, you're poking your finger in the eye of, you know, affluence and happiness, how they're linked together.
And there are just so many factors that go into that whole ideal of happiness. And I think that especially young people, you know, measure their happiness by, you know, other people's standards, by other people's happiness. And I think that that's really a scary thing for young people to have to do or find themselves in.
I think it lent an added buoyancy. By the time I was writing the most intense passages about basically human loneliness, we were deep into lockdown, and that provided the kind of atmosphere that I needed, I think, the impetus.
Fomented the ideas, did it not?
Yes, it did. It did.
Positivity through physicality. Everybody says, "Oh, go out, go for a walk to brighten your mind up." But Grace has really uniquely discussed some of this in her works about, you know, going out and seeing the special things of life and being outside and finding the positivity outside. And I'd like you to talk a little bit about that now, if you would, Grace, please.
Forests have always kind of been there for me. I was brought up around the Black Forest, which is in Germany. I've always kind of felt that whenever I go into the forest, I find this peace. And in Japan, they call it even forest bathing. So it's actually like a form of therapy. And yeah, definitely I find that this physical aspect of therapy and finding your peace within is a great way to let go and find resources within that are there for free. And so nature is kind of this therapy that has been given to us from God, that when we can go outside and connect with nature, we don't have to do anything. It just comes natural. Do you know what I mean? It's just like...
I would say that one of the messages of the book is watch for opportunities. When you've got a wish and you want a career change or whatever, whether you want to go wild and go to the Caribbean or whether you want to just change careers and go do something different, watch for opportunities because they're always there. They're just, sometimes you ignore them. We could have ignored that little picture that said, come and work in paradise. And if we'd ignore that, we might still be working in the corporate world.
Yeah. The bottom line is persistence. If you want to get this done, if you want something you want published, don't give up. Don't give up with it. There's lots of ways to do things. And at the time I did the first book, the poetry book and the first YouTube book, as Chris said, there wasn't much going on in the way of self-publishing. Now, you have so many options.
Say it, everyone.
Persist in writing, persist in getting your work.
Well, and you also, you talk about being patient. Patience and persistence, those the two P's, you know, because it's never easy. And you keep a stiff upper lip and you look to the rest of the world and say, I'm trying to publish, I'm trying to be found. Please find me, love my works.
And it just... And so, I mean, I could blame these doctors all day long, but at the end of the day, I took them, and, you know, maybe I should have done my due diligence, and maybe it's a lesson to be learned that, you know, doctors, you know, aren't perfect either, and sometimes I would suggest all the time it's good to do your own due diligence on the drugs you're taking, and make sure that, you know, you're being prescribed the right things.
Well, I think that's one of the great takeaways from this book. Is that you have told your story through these characters, and now it is out there for
for the world to consume. And, you know, perhaps maybe if you just reach one person, just one person, it's worth writing the book. And,
absolutely.
You know, I'm tickled pink that you wrote it, and I'm tickled pink that you told the story, and I'm sick as hell that you had to do
you know, get into this massive, you know, crafting of a civilization. How did you get your mind into that, Jack?
Those books inspired me to want to tell my own story, you know, and that's really where it comes from, is the inability I had as a kid to go and do the things other kids did. I had to be very careful. After my second surgery, in fact, I started having all sorts of allergies, and so spring had come and everybody else is, and I'm there with tears running down my swollen eyes, and you know, it was awful, wheezing. So I was very much restricted in what I could do.
Yeah.
And this is what I did.
Beliefs. Can you imagine what this world would be like? I can.
Incredible world, wouldn't it? Yeah.
And that's what these people, dozens and dozens of those people, are saying. In fact, I read a review on my book's Amazon page from a woman I do not know, who, yes, indeed, she loved the book, but the last sentence of her review, paraphrasing because I don't remember the exact words, but she said, "I hope Why Are There Monkeys and Other Questions for God becomes a giant bestseller, because if it does, this world will become a much better place."
All right, so you were born in Nigeria, you made it to Atlanta, and then you went back to Nigeria, is that the case?
Yes, I was born in Nigeria, did most of my life in Nigeria, and then I went to Miami first,
uh-huh,
and went to fashion school in Miami, and then ended up moving to Atlanta because I wanted to explore more places. And then it was there in Atlanta that I started my hairstyling business. I learned my hairstyling on YouTube, and then I started to have clients and meet people and all of that.
Uh-huh. And that's where you started developing heart palpitations and stress. That's what the United States can do for
yes,
you, right?
Yes, that's exactly how I was doing. I was releasing one chapter per week, and after each chapter, I was receiving some more readers. Of course, I didn't start with like a huge public. In the very beginning, it was like 10 readers, 15 readers, but with the time and with the development of the novel, I start receiving more public.
Now, in terms of coming up with the print novel, did you base your decision on what would make it into the print novel versus just stay into the web version, based upon the number of viewers or the number of readers that you had for that particular channel? Like, if you have 25,000 viewers, that has to be in the printed version, or versus those channels, they maybe only have 200 or 300 viewers, you left that stuff out. Did you do that?
It was a mix of that, but also a mix of the opinion of those constant readers, because it's easy that you have one chapter with 20,000 viewers, but to keep those 20,000 viewers, you also have to have some magic on your book that's catching the public attention.
It helps to have a granddaughter that knows what she's doing, doesn't
it? The problem with it is that if you're concentrating on that stuff, then you're concentrating on that stuff. You're not being creative and writing. And I did find for a couple of months this year that I was so taken up with marketing the book and actually doing very well with it, that there was no creativity left for writing.
There was. And that's another one of those issues that lies beneath, is that, you know, sometimes your next door neighbor might look like they're the happiest marriage ever, but ultimately it's a loveless marriage where they don't even talk to each other. And we don't know these things about each other, do we?
Yeah, right. And I think, you know, you bring up a good point, because in my book, you know, you do have four couples, four marriages, and it turns out that only one of them at the end really was in, you know, really good shape.
Has written some of the most questionable and scary things that you could possibly imagine in your darkest, deepest dreams. He has done these things, and he's willing to talk to us about it today. Christopher Berry, the author of Talking with Serial Killers.
I was in a junk shop, a second-hand shop in my city, and I found some very old Times newspaper cuttings dating back to 1927. And I looked at them and I suddenly saw my grandfather's name on there, Oscar Berry Tompkins. And he was a solicitor for one of the two men who shot PC Guttridge in Essex in 1927, shot him between the eyes, and they both hanged. And I got these newspaper cuttings and I thought, oh, I'd like to write about, and I wrote a book, if you could call it a book. And I sent it to W.H. Allen, and I didn't get a reply. And then about a month later, I asked them if they'd read it. And then I got a letter from Robin O'Dell, who's the UK's greatest crime historian. And he said, look, I've read your manuscript, Christopher. And this is a highly respected guy, Robin. And he said, it's the worst writing I've ever had to see in my life. It's terrible. He said, but the research is flawless.
In the UK, now they're in the UK. They were in the US, and now there's Breaking Rules published in Europe. So my last three books have been published with them, which is a small independent publisher. It still kind of feels like you're self-publishing, but you know, they do a lot of work to help you. You still have to do a lot of marketing and publicizing yourself. You know, the small magazines and small publishers don't have that great deal of money to do the marketing, so I feel you have to do a lot of it yourself. That's okay. That's the world.
Well, and that's why we have podcasts and videos like this. And
exactly.
We have YouTube, yeah. And we have all kinds of ways to get the word out there, because you shouldn't have to go to a Simon & Schuster in order to get your book out there.
One thing that I try not to do is put too much detail into things. I know a lot of novelists, a lot of writers love to throw details, tell you every little thing. I like to let the imagination of the reader take hold and kind of give you those fine little details. So it's just... It's good for your imagination to read this book, I guess I should say.
Well, and I think it's perfectly timed, because you are the father of two rambunctious kids, and you hear them in the background back there. Oh, and you're not killing anybody in the house. That is a perfectly natural sound for a father of two kids to be screaming in the background.
Sorry about that.
You know,